Your Eminence, Metropolitan Kallistos, thank you so much for entertaining this interview. It's a true delight to have His Eminence Metropolitan Kallistos of Dioclea visiting with us today and giving us an interview on behalf of Patristic Nectar Publications. His Eminence doesn't need much of an introduction at all to anyone in the English-speaking Orthodox world. He is perhaps the most well-known Orthodox Christian in the English-speaking world. His books have contributed to the edification of many, many persons and are read all over the world. He was for many decades, for about 35 years, a professor at Oxford University, as well as a son of the church and a priest and then a bishop of the church in England. And now in his retirement, if you can call it retirement, is traveling all over the world, lecturing and speaking and continuing his academic studies. Our theme today for this interview is the subject of the Philokalia, a collection of spiritual texts from the 4th to the 15th century of the greatest value to Orthodox Christians, the English translation of which Metropolitan Kallistos was intimately involved with. These fantastic volumes, the first four of five volumes in the English language, were edited and translated by Metropolitan Kallistos and two colleagues. And if I could start there, Your Eminence, would you tell us a little bit about the Philokalia? What is the Philokalia?
What is the Philokalia? Yes. You have already described it briefly. It is a collection of spiritual texts, texts dealing with the practice of the Christian life, and particularly with inner prayer. And there are in the Philokalia about 35 different writers from the 4th to the 15th century. The Philokalia was originally published as a single volume, a large folio tome of 1,200 pages in double column. And it was printed in Greek in 1782 in Venice. But the editors were both in Greece itself. They were Saint Macarius, who was former Bishop of Corinth, and Saint Nicodemus, the Hagiorite, who was a monk of the holy mountain of Athos. Mm-hmm. Now, the word Philokalia could mean just an anthology, but it bears a deeper sense. Literally, it signifies love of beauty, of spiritual beauty, love of things beautiful, love of God as the supreme beauty and source of all things beautiful. There are a number of unifying themes in the Philokalia. One of the most important is the practice of the Jesus Prayer, the invocation of the holy name, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy on me. But the Philokalia is very much more than simply a manual of how to say the Jesus Prayer. It covers the whole range of Christian life. It is not specifically concerned with sacraments. Baptism and Eucharist are mentioned, but they're not the main theme. The main theme is inner prayer. And we could sum up the message of the Philokalia in the words of the Gospel, the kingdom of heaven is within you. The conviction that lies behind the Philokalia is that within each one of us there is an inner kingdom. And we can enter this realm, a realm full of wonder, full of spiritual space, full of mysteries. We can enter this through prayer. There's a sentence by the 7th century writer St. Isaac the Syrian I don't think it comes in the Greek Philokalia, but it sums up the message of the Philokalia. Be at peace with your own soul, then heaven and earth will be at peace with you. Enter eagerly into the treasure house that lies within you, and so you will discover the treasure house of heaven, for there is but one single entry to them both. Enter into yourself, dive deeply within yourself, and you will discover the steps by which to ascend. That, I think, sums up the basic message of the Philokalia.
Your Eminence, what was the genesis of the collection of these spiritual texts together? Who made this selection, and why did they make it?
That is a very difficult question to answer. We do not really know. Some people think that it was the decision of, more particularly, St. Macarius of Corinth, who chose the texts, and that then he brought the text to St. Nicodemus, who edited them and prepared them for publication. But probably St. Macarius was not simply relying on his own individual judgment. It seems that there was a pre-existing tradition that on the holy mountain of Athos, it was a custom by spiritual fathers to recommend particular works to their disciples. And so we do not find in manuscript on the holy mountain anything corresponding exactly to the collection of the Philokalia. But we do find manuscripts which have many of the texts that are in the Philokalia. Mm-hmm. So it seems there was a pre-existing monastic tradition, a kind of agreed approach of selecting certain works which were recommended to those pursuing the life of prayer.
Your Eminence, is there a schema behind the layout of the texts themselves as we see them, at least in the English volumes that have come out? Is there some ordering of the texts?
In the Greek Philokalia, the texts are placed simply in historical order, according to chronology. So the earliest text is a work attributed to St. Antony of Egypt in the 4th century, though most people think it's not actually by him. And the latest texts come from the 15th century, from people like St. Mark of Ephesus. So in its presentation, the Philokalia is not systematic, but chronological. When the Philokalia was later translated into Russian, at the end of the 19th century, by St. Theophan the Recluse, then there was more of a grouping of texts by subject matter, but even so, it was not done systematically. So the Philokalia is not really a book to read from cover to cover, starting with page 1 and ending with page 1207. It's better to have guidance from your spiritual father, if you have one, from reading books and articles, guidance as to which texts you should start with. For example, I usually recommend people to begin with a text at the end of the Philokalia from the 14th century, the 100 texts concerning Hezekiah, inner stillness, written by Callistos and Ignatios Xanthopoulos. And then I would say go back to the first volume, read Evagrius, 153 texts on prayer, and then perhaps look in the second volume, read the life of Abba Philemon, and then move on to certain other texts. Mm-hmm. The Philokalia is a difficult work, and in our English translation, we have not included a lot of explanatory footnotes. We want the texts to speak for themselves. What we have done is include a short glossary at the end discussing the key texts. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, people need personal guidance from an experienced elder about how to read the Philokalia, or they need to read, there are some good books on the Philokalia, one published recently, edited by Brock Bingaman and Bradley Nassif on the Philokalia, published by the Oxford University Press. That will offer people some help.
What is the title of that book, Your Eminence?
I do not remember exactly, but the words, the Philokalia, come in the title.
You mentioned your collaboration, your work in English translation. Would you share with us a little bit about how this came about? How did you connect with this project?
Yes. As I said, the Philokalia was originally published in Greek at Venice, 1782, during the Ottoman period, when the Greek church was oppressed by Turkish rule. It was fairly quickly translated into Slavonic by Saint Paisi Velichkovsky, who had been on the Holy Mountain some 20 years before the Greek Philokalia appeared, and he already was translating most of the works in the Greek Philokalia independently of Macarius and Nicodemus, relying on a pre-existing tradition. Now, the Greek Philokalia was not reprinted for more than 100 years. The second edition came out around 1893. And then another 2 generations passed before the third edition of the Greek Philokalia came out in 1957 and the years following. So the Greek Philokalia was not exactly a bestseller. Mm-hmm. 3 editions in nearly 200 years. But since 1957, it's been reprinted a number of times in Greece, and there are at least 2 translations of the Philokalia into modern Greek. Mm-hmm. Because the texts in the original Philokalia are in the Byzantine Greek that is not easily understood by Greeks today. The Slavonic Philokalia was quite popular. Many people will know the little book called The Way of a Pilgrim, about a Russian pilgrim, a cripple, an orphan, who goes from monastery to monastery, and in his knapsack he has the Bible, and the other book in his knapsack is the Philokalia, mm-hmm. in the Slavonic translation. And that work, translated into Western languages around 1930 and afterwards, has been very popular. It's written in an easy, attractive style. And so that made the Philokalia better known. But then there was a translation the end of the 19th century into Russian of the Philokalia, and this was quite widely circulated before the revolution. The real era of the Philokalia, however, is not in the Greek world of the late 18th century under the Ottomans, and not in Holy Russia of the 19th century. The real era of the Philokalia has been in the second half of the 20th century. The first English translation of the Philokalia was done in 1952, and the second volume came out later in the 1950s, a selection of texts. And the translation was made from the Russian. And the translator was an Englishman, Gerald Palmer, who came from a wealthy family. Before the Second World War, he'd been a member of Parliament. Mm-hmm. He joined the Orthodox Church, and with the encouragement of his spiritual father, a monk on Mount Athos, Father Nikon, he continued with translations of the Philokalia that he'd begun to make before he was Orthodox. And he had a Russian lady to help him, Madame Evgenia Katlubovsky. And so that was how, with the encouragement of an Athenite monk, two Orthodox living in Britain produced the first English translations in the 1950s. Now, it was quite difficult for them to find an English publisher. Mm-hmm. They sent it to a well-known publisher, Faber and Faber. And the people at Faber said, no doubt these texts are very interesting, but they will only appeal to very few people. Mm-hmm. It could never be a commercial success. But one of the directors of Faber's, the celebrated poet T.S. Eliot, said, these texts are of such importance that they should be published. Even if we lose a lot of money, let us undertake that. And so, the first volume was printed in 1952. And Faber's thought, nobody's going to buy this book. So they printed about 2,000 copies, but they only bound a few dozen. And then, to their surprise, demands for the book came in. And they had hastily to bind all the other volumes. And since 1952, that volume called Writings from the Philokalia on Prayer of the Heart, that's been reprinted about 15 or 20 times. Incredible. So Faber's, in fact, made a lot of money. So that illustrates what our Lord said, seek first the kingdom of heaven, and everything else will be given to Touché. You as well.
Touché.
But translations have been made in other languages since the Second World War. In Romanian, the Romanian edition by the celebrated theologian Father Dimitri Stanilaue has a lot of other texts in addition to the ones in the Greek Philokalia. And it's now run to 11 volumes, perhaps more.
Are these texts that he selected, or were they in the Slavonic?
They were not in the Slavonic for the most part. The Russian the Slavonic Philokalia is exactly the same as the Greek. Mm-hmm. The Russian Philokalia is already expanded edition, but Stanilaue, following the traditions of Romanian monasticism, included a lot of other texts. But there are now more or less complete texts in translation of the Philokalia in French, in Italian, in Finnish, in Arabic, I think in Spanish, probably not in German. And in English, the original translations made in the 50s by Palmer and Katlubowski have now been largely superseded by a new translation made from the original Greek in 5 volumes. 4 volumes have appeared. The 5th volume is waiting for me to work on the editing.
Forgive me, but let me ask you more about the 5th volume. Your Eminence, you say it lacks editing. This is a thirsty soul wondering when the water of life will be delivered on the 5th volume. Do you have plans in the near future to be working on this? Or is it behind several other projects?
I am deeply penitent that there has been such a delay. my two collaborators, Gerald Palmer, who was responsible for the original Philo Caliere of the 50s, and Philip Sherard, have both died. I only am left, and I'm not so young. So it depends on me to bring the project to completion without, alas, their help. In fact, a lot of preliminary work has been done. What I must do is not go traveling, not go giving lectures at conferences, not spend my time giving interviews, but simply stay quietly at home and work on the Philo Caliere. Don't answer letters, don't answer the telephone, just sit and work. And I think that if only I can clear my desk of other tasks, because I have had a lot of other responsibilities in the last 20 years, if I can only clear my desk this year, most of the remaining work will be done. So we might hope that it would come out perhaps in 2015. But I do hope I will have strength and time to complete this task. I owe it to my friends, Gerald and Philip.
We hope as well. We hope as well, Your Eminence. Could you give us a foreshadowing? What is in the fifth volume?
The fifth volume consists almost entirely of writings by persons called Callistos. Same name as I have. There are probably three of them. Callistos Kataphygiotes, who may have been of the 12th century, maybe a bit later. Callistos Angelicudes, who is 14th century. And Callistos and Ignatius Xanthopoulos, the author of the 100 texts on the life of Hezekiah, which I've already mentioned. And I think the work of Callistos and Ignatius Xanthopoulos is the most important. There are one or two other short texts by other people, St. Mark of Ephesus, for example. Now, all of these people were writing, with the possible exception of Callistos Kataphygiotes, in the period after the middle of the 14th century. The middle of the 14th century was marked by the celebrated Hesychast or Palamite controversy, a dispute which involved the whole tradition of inner mystical prayer that the Philo Caliere represents, and which was attacked by certain other Greeks. And this tradition was defended by St. Gregory Palamas. There was a fierce controversy, but the Hesychast, Palamite, Philokalic approach prevailed. And in the fourth volume of the Philokalia, the two chief authors are the two Gregories. St. Gregory of Sinai, who died probably about 1347, St. Gregory Palamas, who died 1359. They are the chief writers in the fourth volume. In the fifth volume, these authors come after the Hesychast controversy. They accept the principles of Palamite theology. They are not writing in a controversial situation with the need to defend this tradition against hostile attacks. So they are able to write, we might say, in a spirit of greater detachment and equanimity, far from any polemic. And yes, some of the texts in the fifth volume are quite complex, were difficult to translate, difficult to understand, but I think the century of Callistos and Ignatius Xanthopoulos forms an excellent Hesychast Vadimacum, a little handbook on hesychasm, and it's full of texts from the earlier writers in this tradition. Now, that work did appear in the early English translation, which I mentioned, the writings from the Philokalia on Prayer of the Heart by Kadlubovsky and Palmer, but it was made from the Russian, so I think making a translation from the Greek will give it a greater accuracy and sharpness of outline. Mm-hmm.
21st century Christians find it difficult, Your Eminence, with traditional Christian theological categories and vocabulary. The Philokalia presents many concepts and words, nous, passions, watchfulness, nepsis, contemplation, theoria, that could be stumbling blocks, obstacles to the reader today. Why should a 21st century Christian push through those obstacles to read the Philokalia today?
That's a good question. First of all, going back to the 18th century, we note two different approaches. St. Paisy Velichkovsky did not originally want his Slavonic translations to be printed. He thought that the texts in the Philokalia should be kept in manuscript and should be given by spiritual fathers to their children only to individual people whom they thought were spiritually prepared, and that these texts should not be read without guidance. But Saint Nicodemus of the Holy Mountain was of a different opinion. He admitted that the texts were difficult. He agreed that it was highly desirable to have guidance from an experienced teacher. But he considered that these texts should not be restricted and hidden. And he said, we must trust the Holy Spirit. If some people go astray because they don't have spiritual guidance, yet many, many more will be helped by these texts. So he considered that they should be printed. Once you put a book in print, you can't restrict who's going to read it. And he admitted that not everyone would have the proper guidance they need, but he hoped the Holy Spirit would prevail. And so he entrusted the work to the world. St. Theophan the Recluse had a similar approach, the editor of the Russian Philokalia. In his correspondence, people write to him saying, tell me where I can find a spiritual father, where I can find someone who will solve all my problems, who will give me answers to everything. And Theophan replies again and again, perhaps God doesn't wish you to have a spiritual father like that, who will relieve you of all responsibility for yourself. Perhaps you must listen to the voice of God in your own conscience. Read the scriptures humbly. They will tell you what you need. And so Theophan also believed that it was important to print these texts and make them available. And that was the attitude equally of Father Nikon, who encouraged Gerald Palmer and Evgenia Kadlubovsky to publish their translations. Now, the Philokalia is a difficult work. It does require from people a committed effort. Perhaps many people will be baffled and will need help. There is much more help available now in different books by different people on the tradition of the Philokalia much more than 50 years ago. But I believe, like Saint Nicodemus, that we should trust the Holy Spirit. Sometimes people have criticized us for making an English translation available. They say this is not a text to be read by everyone. I say God guides people to read the books they need. What has astonished me is that it's quite clear the Philokalia is very often read by people who are not Orthodox, but belong to other Christian churches. And not only that, it is often being read by people who are not Christians, not members of any church tradition. Now, of course, if you're going to practice a thing like the Jesus Prayer, you ought to be a practicing Christian, regularly receiving the sacraments of confession and communion. But God moves in a mysterious way. God has many ways of calling people outside the normal channels. And it's quite clear that non-Christians reading the Philokalia have been significantly helped in their own spiritual life. Perhaps they've not necessarily become Christians. Things are not as simple as that, to say, well, everybody's going to become a Christian. We have to accept that there are persons of deep spirituality who don't belong to any church. And it's clear that some of these persons of deep spirituality outside any church life have found the Philokalia immensely helpful. Mm-hmm. So, yes, it is meant for people who are within the church and practicing members, but it has an outreach far beyond that. Now, why has the Philokalia appealed so widely in the second half of the 20th century? It was planned by Macarius and Nicodemus for a totally different world, the Greek world under Ottoman rule, 18th century. And yet, the moment for the Philokalia, its kairos, its special time of opportunity, has been the last 50, 60 years. In that way, the Philokalia could be seen as a spiritual time bomb, which has in fact spoken to an age long after its first publication and to a totally different cultural situation. I can only say, I believe that God speaks to every human heart. Within every human person, there is a God-shaped hole that only He can fill. Within every human person, there is a thirst for salvation in Christ, even if the people in question don't realize it. And somehow, the Philokalia, difficult though it is, has appealed to people who have not been drawn by more obvious popular books. Somehow, in our secular postmodern age, when institutional Christianity is being challenged in North America and Western Europe, somehow the Philokalia has a message. Seek the inner kingdom. A message that people need to hear. And that's why I count it an immense privilege to have been associated with the translation of the Philokalia.
Your Eminence, thank you for your ministry in this area and for your many hours of labor, of love, to bring the Philokalia into an accessible format for English-speaking seekers.